siapa yang kaki tak mampu kuat, ikut tangga sini balik. Siapa yang nak cepat, yang kaki kuat, dia ikut tangga bawah tadi depan. Lagi terus ke grandstand depan ni. Dan seterusnya, kita akan pergi pandang kejap. Lepas pandang tu, kita pergi south stand. South stand, jadi kita akan pergi, kita ada ambil gambar sikit. Dan kita akan pergi ke scoreboard. Sebab, dua dah sana. Nanti saya nak bagi itulah, you all. Saya nak make sure you all sepanjang perjalanan ni, you all akan ambil note. Supaya you all aware. Sebab sekarang ni, masalah dengan manusia sekarang, dia kurang observation skill. Kita sebagai human, artificial intelligence is good. But natural intelligence is also very important as well. Because in order for you to survive, it's not just about your AI, but also your NI. So NI kena terjadi supaya kita ni sebagai seorang manusia, kita kena ada keupayaan untuk fokus dan juga memburu. Kenapa kita memburu? Sebab kita ada fokus. Paling penting, skillnya apa? Observation, perhatian. Okay, so nanti fahamkan mana itu Malaysia, jantan negara, bendera, kenapa colour macam tu. Kalau siapa ada duit lagi, tak pakai duit wallet, boleh tengok duit dia enggak. Nanti ada sikit-sikit kita tanya lagi sikit soalan tu. Just a bit of trivia saja. Kedua-kedua sikit. Jadi sebelum kita mula, sebab mengikut adat besar orang Asia, kita masuk belakang dulu. Baik, kita ambil kanan. Yang menyebabkan stadium mereka ni dibina. Okay. Dalam banyak-banyak kawasan di Malaysia ketika itu, di Tanah Melayu, do you know where is the 0 mile? Kilometer kosong tu di mana?
Pejabat pos.
Biasanya pejabat pos. Kenapa pejabat pos?
Waiting nak hantar surat.
Hantar surat. Telegram. So, you always start off 0 kilometer, you always start off from either pejabat pos, balai polis, ataupun stesen kereta api. Which is why originally stesen kereta api adalah di situ. Ending dia kat belakang Pian Pertanian. Pian Pertanian lah, Agrobank kan. Belakang. Dia ada di belakang museum tekstil. Dia tu dulu tu is a station lah. Station kereta api. Station kereta api lah. Dia ke depan tu. Dekat yang daya bumi. Belakang daya bumi. So, kat situ you notice all the building are very colonial. So, it does not resemble whatever that Tunku wants to showcase the Malaysia as a modern nation. So, after looking around, he feel that this is the best place. Because why? Waktu ketika tu, this is considered outskirt tau. City center was actually in colonial. Dia punya paling jauh sekali sampai Central Market je. It's not that big. You cannot imagine as compared to nowadays punya city center. Dulu punya city center is very confined. Dia macam ikut zaman European kan, dipanggil fortification city kan, kota kan. Dia duduk dalam tu je. Macam you tengok Game of Thrones ke, you tengok cerita Lord of the Ring ke kan. Dia duduk dalam kota saja. Dia takkan keluar dari situ. Dia takkan exit. Why? Safety purposes. Security purposes lah. Right? That's one reason. So, waktu ketika tu, orang kebanyakan, dia tak ada tanah tau. So, dia kena apply dengan British melalui persatuan. So, waktu ketika tu, siapa yang apply tanah dengan British, British bagi. Tapi, kau kena keluar sikit. This is the place lah. This is the outskirt. This is area Pudu. Area Pudu kan? So, that's why you notice, ada Stadium Cinggu, ada Persekutuan Pengakak, ada gereja Wesley, ada gereja macam-macam pergi, YWCA, semua along this road. And
was it squatter area before?
It's not really a squatter. It's
what was it?
Previously, it was officially, it was partly a small settlement during the early days before the British came. And then, they were used for some of them still a graveyard. Some of it, the graveyard is still around the idea part. And then later on, they use it for Royal Selangor Blockhouse. Yeah. Originally, this is the one. This is what we call Bukit Petaling. Kalau nama Petaling Jaya kan, this is the starter of Bukit Petaling. Kan? So Bukit Petaling is including Istana Negara. It was one particular hill. That hill is also where Yat Alloy was, dia punya top dia kat belakang. So this is actually basically totally outskirt lah. Dia orang kata paling hujung lah, hujung bandar. So during that time, British bagi semua tanah-tanah kepada persatuan. Persatuan tabik sini pun ada. So that's why this sini memang banyak tanah persatuan. But this area, it was confined for recreational. for some of the KLites, they might know this as the Coronation Park. Kalau orang VI, my father is a VI boy. He mentioned, oh, ayah dulu main Sapporo. Sapporo resemble to the story of Olympic in Sapporo. Olympic, Winter Olympic in Sapporo. Kenapa? Main bobsleigh. Sebab sini kawasan DVD. So, dia orang main bobsleigh. Dia punya pulang lagi lah, so, dia turun. It was a joke upon themselves lah. But for people that know that Sapporo-hi, itu banyak refer to KLites from VI lah. So, they always use it. This was known as a public park. Coronation Park. Then later on, Tunku says, where is the best place to symbolize unity? We have to find something which is public. And after looking around, this is the best place. And also considering the construction basis. Why? If you notice, this is a natural slope. The stadium is actually sunken. It's a slope. Where we're sitting now is a slope actually. Slope going down. That's why the seating is actually on the slope. So because why? We use construction time. And at the same time, the earth, the work, the soil that we move up, they transfer pergi Masjid Negara. No. Whatever left, yang punya, dia pindah pergi Masjid Negara sebab waktu ketika tu Masjid Negara pun tengah buat construction. So it save a lot of time because of it's a valley by itself. And then considering that as well, if you notice, this one is an axis of north and south. So that is the east, that is the west. So basically it's on the axis, and that is why the grandstand is here. Facing the morning side. One of the reason lah. So feng shui pun ada, ventilation pun ada sebab ventilation of the wind coming in. So that's why dia ada open air. So this is by far during the construction. This is during the completion of this particular stadium. They have two world record. 1957, Malaya ada two world record. On this stadium alone. The largest cantilever roof shaft. And also the tallest pre-stressed floodlight. Believe it or not, 1957 kita ada dua record on this building alone. Can you imagine? Malaysia memang dari dulu ni semua punching above the wind. So that is the nature of Malaysia lah. It's not about to show off, but it shows that our spirit. So and looking back from this part, I cannot imagine how is it going to feel masa kita tengah main bola, masa kita ada sukasi. It must be amazing. I have the experience of being here once for an event. I think it was Pesta Bola Merdeka. But it was very rare. It's like hazy in my head lah. But I can remember the sound, the voice, the noise was created by Malaysian kan. Pakcik India pun datang, you boleh ke? Ni semua. Cerita tu akan selalu bermain dekat kita punya mindset. And that is what is missing among us nowadays. And that is what Tunku wants. Tunku wants people of Malaysia coming here, not to see everybody is different, but to see people different but with the same vision. I think that's what the key idea. So we go down a little bit, so to understand a little bit more to be a royal family. Come down. You can mention this one is pretty steep. Siapa yang tak berani boleh ikut tangga sini. This is the grandstand lah. You can see the voice kan. Auntie boleh ke auntie? Baik, right, kalau tak boleh, saya angkat.
Dia turun lah.
Dia tinggi sikit kalau dia nak masuk ikut tangga boleh. Ada segala pemberian. The main structure, I would say, the main part of the building, where you can see almost all the events lah. And during the time of the proclamation of independence, Tunku was here lah. So he was facing that. So when he was raising his arm, his hand, literally just in front of, just before the circle, just around that corner, which is that was the one that inspired the PNV 118. You can see the spear. On top of that, is because of taking the inspiration of Tengku punya raising arm lah. So that was the part of the story where we try to give something back to the next generation by giving them some theme. and clue. Kenapa you all buat macam ni? You all buat macam ni? Ah, that's how I come. And I will try to explain so that you will understand the narrative from the beginning of the 1957 or even before that, coming after up to the current, either 2024 or 2023, I don't know. Oh, how long can we sustain as a nation? But hopefully for a long time lah, right? So this is where all the big delegates will be around. And you can see during that time, all these items that you see is actually based on the original design.
Based on the original design.
Basically in 2001, when it was decided that Stadium Merdeka is not to be demolished, they were coming with effort for conservation. And they even have a conservation management plan. They have a proper DLAC study. They have deep measured drawing. All this on architecture basis untuk mendapatkan dokumentasi yang tepat. Supaya kalau dia tak sama 100%, almost close, setara. Jika tak 100%, sebab kadang-kadang teknologi dia berubah-ubah. Contoh penggunaan elektrik, kita punya speaker memang akan berubah. Zaman akan berubah. Di dalam konteks conservation, pemuliharaan bangunan ataupun tapak, kita dibenarkan untuk mengubah mengikut keperluan. Sekiranya berkaitan dengan teknologi, berkaitan dengan keselamatan. Sebab contohlah, menara pisah, dia sengit. Kenapa dia tak pernah tegak kan? Sebab that is the story. The story of telling people that during that time, is very important. Ketika itu, the knowledge about foundation is not much. About understanding about the soil is not much. Understanding how to build a skyscraper is not that much. So, it give a knowledge and also, orang kata apa, pengajaran. How not to do it. So, kalau you tegakkan balik, dia jadi biasa. The same goes to Menara Condong Teluk Intan. Kenapa kita tak tegakkan Menara Condong tu? Boleh je nak tegak kan? Tak ada masalah pun. Tapi, kalau orang negeri kata, kalau tegak ya, tak jadi eh. Tapi bila dia bengkok, baru orang jadi. So, sometimes the imperfection make things interesting. So, that is the beauty of some of them. Kita tak panggil dia cacat tau. Kalau cacat tu is a bad word. Kita panggil dia karakter. Dia ada karakter. Some people, I mean, even the word of OKU kan, I also don't like to use OKU per se. But we call it special needs, we have called it a special golden generation. Nowadays, it's all about how to make sure that you are not offending a lot of people, but also giving motivation as well. Sebab kadang-kadang terms play a big role in giving us the motivation of moving forward. So, and quickly before the sun goes up, kita go feeling of the grass. So definitely the grass is not the same. Whoever tell me that the grass is the same as 1957.
The soil has it been?
Yes, definitely.
You've changed everything.
Because the drainage.
Okay.
Before this, we don't have drainage. What is the rainfall? It's a fact lah. Dia akan sama ada dia bertahun kejap ataupun lama saja. So that was the issue when everybody kalau berlari main bola, you always have to go. Because of playing football in Malaysia is very tiring. Because you have heavy food. Basah kan? So you nak lari, dia kena nyampak. That's not the reason to make it. So Malaysia ni nampak, you tak pernah terus kat Malaysia. You almost like running in the sand now. Penat. Because satu lagi humidity kita sangat tinggi. So kita cepat haus, kita cepat penat. And then kita punya pressure, angin tak sama. The wind lagi velocity, and then on top of that is the heat. The heat tu yang kadang-kadang the snap. If you play around during that time, kalau you tak properly warming up ataupun stretching, you can get easily lah injury, bad injury. So who is the famous that grace along this way? You might say Michael Jackson, you might say Celine Dion, but for me the most important iconic figure in this stadium is Muhtar Ali. That is by far is the biggest icon that I can remember.
Sure.
Because he does not stand there on himself. He stand there with the team. But he managed to play hand by hand with Diego Maradona. Remember, Boca Juniors was here. Muhammad Ali was here. The late Muhammad Ali was here. 1975, 1974. But it's almost impossible lah. During that time, he was there on the height, on the speak of his, orang kata, power kan. Play with Joe
Bangkang,
isn't it? Memang tak ada apa lah. And I remember listening to some of my father's friend, Bengay VI lah. The street was empty. Nobody was around. 1974, when Muhammad Ali came, somehow he managed to silence the country. Because everybody was looking forward for that particular match. Even though it's a orang kata apa, one-sided match lah. Tapi because of Muhammad Ali, and Muhammad Ali is willing to come to this part of the world.
Here or at Stadium Negara?
Stadium. Stadium Negara alone.
There's a photo of him with this.
If you see one of the picture, he was fighting along the ring over here. The background of the shell roof is there, at the back. Fantastic. But for me, the most iconic person that ever graced Stadium Negara, that made Stadium Negara as popular as it is Mohtar Dhani. Without a shadow of doubt.
And thank God during the fight, there's no rain, right?
Yes. Luckily. Luckily. If not, he might also swearing lah. Yeah. Dia kata, nothing kan. By the time dia sampai, kena hujan kita, memang kiok. Our rainfall is one of the thing. Because you put one cup of one cup in the middle of the field, you can fill out within less than 10 minutes. Because our intensity. That's why flash flood kalau dekat KL is very, very difficult. So, you can see from there. You can take picture. I have another space that you can see the pictures. We go to take pictures at the back. So that one will be a better view. So we move forward to that particular gate on the south stand. If you want.
Be careful, yeah.
Be careful je.
It's a bit
dia ada gap sikit, dia ada drainage. So let's move forward. So anytime that you want to use the stadium is open for public. So kalau siapa nak jogging, tak buat yoga, pagi tadi ada yoga. Ada akan ada craft market during the weekend. So maybe not every weekend, but kalau di weekend ada craft market. So kalau nak buat event tu, sini tak ada masalah. Tapi kita will be open to public. So kalau siapa-siapa rasa nak turun badan di stadium legenda ni, boleh datang kan? Come. Tanya lah, saya tanya tadi lah. Bendera Malaysia, jatah negara, duit Malaysia, apa yang saya nak tanya ni? Nanti saya ada soalan. It will be very interesting sebab it's actually a social experiment.
Very careful, yeah.
It's still work on progress. Tak, jadi saya nak letak semua orang masuk badan. Terus naik atas boleh ikut Hakim. Hakim nanti bawa pergi ke sana, ya. Okay.
Point.
ni satu rekod ingat ni.
Ni.
Satu lagi dia dalam apa? Jadi itu. Oh ni open space. Ini kan.
Here's the vantage point.
Kata apa, vista view, tapi ada lagi satu view lagi cantik.
This one of it.
Inside nak tengok PMB 118 at this point of time, this is the best spot lah. Ha, dulu Michael Jackson keluar dari sini lah. Sebab tu dia bawa by truck kan. Nak masuk stadium, dia keluar dari sini. Most of the artists, because of the entrance is from the main road kan.
Concert kan?
Ha, dulu memang concert. Lepas stadium Bukit Jalil dibina, banyak concert buat kat sini dulu. Sebab stadium negara dia tak boleh masuk banyak. Stadium negara is about 10,000. Stadium mereka is about 40,000. And this current is this current design, original design is only 20,000. Before this, we have about 40,000 capacity, but because of dia nak patah balik ke original design, dia demolish the upper tier. Upper tier tu, kita bina untuk sukan C87. 87-89 yang
pertama sekali.
Yes. Ada kat sini sikit, ada kat sana sikit. So, dia nak patah balik pada 1957 punya timeline, dia robohkan balik. So, whatever that we see nowadays is basically based on the design on 1957.
So capacity untuk sekarang adalah
20,000. Lebih kurang 21,000. 3,000 under the roof. 3,000 alone is under the roof.
So,
yes, upper tier tu memang kita roboh. Sebab dia nak patah balik to the conservation value principle. Kita patah balik to the original timeline of 1957. So, they decided to demolish partly of the 1957 lah. Okay. And regarding this site as well, I mentioned just now Tunku was the person, key person that making sure that this building was built, was construct. Then by any chance, I will mention that Tunku is the founder of Stadium Merdeka. But during the heydays of our nation being a very developed country, there was a storyline that this stadium was about to be demolished during the early 90s, right? If you remember, now which is why Stadium Bukit Jalil was built. Kenapa Stadium Bukit Jalil dibina? Dia ada perjanjian untuk ganti. Swapping lah kita panggil. Stadium mereka akan dirobohkan, ganti dengan Stadium Nasional di Bukit Jalil, dan dia akan ambil untuk pembangunan lain di Stadium mereka. Sebab kawasan ni di kawasan tengah bandar kan. So daripada segi nilai hartanah dia sangat tinggi. Without shadow doubt, memang kita akui benda tu memang betul. Tetapi for whatever reason, there's one particular person which is a giant of person yang I call him the reviver. Sebab without that person, he'll never be able to still witness Stadium Merdeka as it is. And that guy was actually Allahyarham Tan Sri Saji Ahmad. Ahmad Saji.
Ahmad Saji.
He was the key person that ensuring somehow he managed to convince Tun Mahathir. During that time, Dr. Mahathir, Tun Sri Dr. Mahathir, to say, okay, you can do after it. You can take over.
Siapa dia tu?
Tu Ahmad Saji was the
Saji also.
Chief Ahmad
Saji. Secretary of Malaysia a long time ago.
Chief Secretary of Malaysia. KSN. KSN waktu ketiga tu, 1990s. So he was a key person that ensuring that this stadium is being made, it's not to be demolished. And it's bought over by PMB, which is why PMB pun the land. Okay? That's one of the reason kenapa stadium ni is di sini. So dua watak penting ni, Tunku Abdul Rahman as the founder, Tun Ahmad Saji as the reviver. Without these two people, we will never be able to witness and understand the value of independence in the form of physical. Kita spiritual mungkin boleh, tetapi kita kena ada bentuk physical juga. Dan Stadium Merdeka is the only one. Sebab tu kita tak panggil dia Stadium Nasional. Kita tak panggil dia Stadium Kebangsaan, kita panggil Stadium Merdeka. If you notice, most of kita punya iconic structure, not not a lot yang dia panggil belakang dia Merdeka. Hanya Stadium Merdeka. Dedicated ni panggil Stadium Merdeka. Yang lain Masjid Negara, Muzium Negara, Stadium Negara, Stadium Nasional, dia tak ada panggil Merdeka. Merdeka is only this building. Because they are the first building or structure being built as a modern nation. So ini projek 0001 lah. Dalam, kalau dalam file JKR agaknya ni 001 as a Malaysia lah. Itu saya punya pendapat lah. Okay, mari kita gerak ke belakang. Okay, this is by far I think the best one that you can really admire the building as a whole. Boleh naik lagi atas sikit kalau nak. Nak ambil gambar dekat sini pun boleh, backdrop belakang ni pun boleh. Siapa-siapa nak ambil gambar boleh, kami ambil gambar. Nak atas sikit pun boleh. Siapa-siapa nak ambil gambar, saya nak ambilkan gambar boleh. Angkat.
Ambil,
saya ambil.
Bagi
black white. Sekarang ni free. First time kena bayar.
Ah, kau nak kena bayar.
Tak ada. Banyak, terima kasih. Very good.
Ha? Nanti kita pergi ambil gambar ramai-ramai.
Kita akan ambil group foto juga eh. So boleh ambil kejap dalam 2-3 minit. Lepas tu kita akan ambil group foto kat sini with everyone.
Merdeka.
Oh, cara lah tu.
Merdeka.
Okay, okay, okay. Nice, Angga. 1, 2, 3.
Merdeka. 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 Akan God send lah. Dia punya matahari betul.
Dah come out dia.
Betul.
And then our team akan tolong ambil gambar. Come. Gather here. Just to read the paper, free newspaper. Nowadays you all semua scroll to the phone, so you never understand. So memang mamak pun dia akan tinggalkan satu paper tu untuk free reading je. Sebab kalau tak ada free reading, orang tak datang minum free diet. So that was the idea. So this is the best vantage view from the east. Kalau nak tengok yang betul-betul from the south part, is actually you look up 118. Belum siap lagi, tengah tu. Between the mosque tu, ada satu bangunan. Dia akan ada galeri dan foyer untuk tengok sampai atas. So that will be where's the new museum for textiles. But that will be completed by maybe end of this year ataupun early next year. So this time, this one is actually the first one from a lot of things that's coming up for PMB 118. So this is the beauty of it lah.
Oh, so PMB 118 is a composition of various real estate.
It's actually, this one is under one land. PMB 118, including the Stadium Negara and okay. Stadium Merdeka is under one land. Under one ownership.
Yeah, it's not owned by
different parties. PNP, Merdeka Ventures is the trustee.
Okay.
Looking after the place. So because they want to give back to the society. So that's why Stadium Merdeka and later on Stadium Negara will be protected for the benefit of the legacy. It's already gazetted. Okay. This one is a national heritage. Okay. I mentioned just now the black plaque. Next time nanti kalau ada tour lain, I will share you what is the iconic 7 building under the Tunku Abdul Rahman. 7 iconic building that resemble identify Malaysia as a new nation. Apart from this one lah. Alright, we go along for that. And this is the driver part. Come. Light ni is about 140 feet. 140 kaki.
Pakai LED ke?
Right now LED sir. Tapi dulu flat light ni I tak tahu lah zaman dulu.
Zaman
using lot electric kot.
Zaman dulu.
Dia pakai piece light. So you want build di situ. Okay. Sebab dia nak cepat. Dia didn't do it.
How long did it take to build the stadium?
1 year.
A year.
How is it possible? I don't know. How is it
possible?
In a year.
Almost impossible to build it.
Eleven. How many
states?
11.
Why 11?
Belum join lagi.
This is the question that I always ask. A lot of people miss out. Sabah and Sarawak. Why? Do you know what does the meaning of the emblem of Malaysia? What does it mean?
Oh,
bersatu. Bersatu. Unity.
Bertambah mutu.
Oh, the unity is strength. It's English.
Yeah.
Bersekutu bertambah mutu Romanized is a little bit later. Do you know that kita punya jata negara telah diubah beberapa kali? Siapa orang Melaka? May I know anybody from Melaka? Anybody from Penang?
Ya.
Haa, betul? Abang, cuba check Penang lah. Betul ke tu?
Betul.
Kenapa betul?
Itu masa saya.
Masa saya?
Ah.
Masa saya. Masa sekarang?
Ayah, Penang Bridge lah.
Haa, Penang Bridge.
Dulu apa tu?
Pokok Pinang lah, Pinang.
Siapa yang perasan? Kalau Melaka apa? Sekarang apa? Sekarang Pokok Melaka.
Bang, sebenarnya Pinang tu ini versi pertama, ini versi yang sebelum Pokok Pinang.
Betul.
Baru Merdeka.
Betul. Lepas tu Pokok Pinang saja, tak ada jambatan. Kalau ada jambatan tahun bila?
86.
Ha?
86.
Lebih kuranglah.
Yeah.
Maksudnya sebab ada jabatan. It shows you that symbolism is very important. Symbolism also inform the period. When is the period? Kenapa berubah? You present. Apa itu nombor saintifik kepada harimau Malaya?
Malayan tiger.
Malayan tiger dalam bahasa Inggeris.
Pantera. Pantera tigris.
Lagi sikit.
Pantera tigris Malaya kot. Lupalah.
Tigris Jacksoni.
Oh ya, Jacksoni. Lupa.
Itu nama dia punya nama saintifik. Pantera Jacksoni. Pantera tigris
Jacksoni.
That is the saintifik of harimau Malaya. Dan harimau Malaya ni memang living within the peninsula of Malaya. Not in Borneo. You notice tak? Borneo tak ada harimau. Dia tak ada carnivore. Carnivore dia buaya.
Boleh masuk hutan selamat lah.
Sebab tu saya pun baru tahu sebenarnya.
Tapi ular?
Ular dia. Dia ada sebab apa? If you baca dia balik archipelago by Alfred Russel Wallace, dia ada mention about the imaginary line of the Wallace line.
Yeah, Wallace line.
That divisate the territory form from the Australian Asia and also the Asia. So the animal that move in between particular continent, they change in nature. So that's why in Bonyol you ada pygmy elephant. Sebab dia dah dia dah acclimatize. Keadaan dia dalam kawasan pulau. Makanan dia kecil sikit sebab dia restricted dalam pulau tadi. Whereas in the main land macam kita masih lagi maintain the size. Right? That's why in Bonyol bayi dia besar. Sebab dia ada only carnivore. And there's no competitor. And to make it even worse, most of the native tribe, dia makan biawak, dia makan ular sawa. So nobody is eating
buaya.
Buaya punya telur. Telur buaya tu tak ada orang makan. That's why buaya tu tak boleh nak control. It's a problem. It's a problem in Borneo. Hmm. So that is part of the story about natural indicator as well. So maksudnya Malaysia ni, if you see, we are the 12th, we are the one of the 12 nation which is under mega diverse country. Mega biodiversity country. Which have more than a lot of abundance of different biodiversity. So kalau korang buka, ada yang ada dekat mandi. So kita datang ni pasal Malaysia ni biodiversity. Ada insect, jamur, insect, Dinosaurus Rex zaman dulu kan. So harimau is that one lah. Harimau Melaya is that one. Because they are very elegant. Very very elegant. And one of their favourite food is kijang. Kijang kat Malaysia ni apa logo dia? Yes. Kenapa logo dia pakai kijang? Baki dia, dalam baki dia pakai baki dia. Kenapa duit. Dia panggil baki dia?
Duit lama lah.
Sebab dia nak halau harimau tu. So dia bak.
Baking dia.
Ah, so dia panggil baking dia. And kijang is unique dan rooster dengan kancil because dia are very narrow dia punya kaki dia. Sebab dia boleh melompat. Sebab tu kita panggil triple jump, lompat kijang. Kita tak panggil lompat tiga kali kan? Kita panggil dia lompat kijang. And because of dia are so sensitive to vibration. And yang boleh lawan dengan dia is tiger. So tiger, nasi kandar dia kijang. So kalau anyone nampak kijang, be very careful. Be very careful. There's a tiger roaming around. Kalau kita selalu dengar buaya kan, buaya air yang tenang dan misal kita ada buaya. Sebab apa? Sebab buaya duduk dekat kuala. Air dia tenang. Dia bukan berarus. Yang duduk di hulu, air dia berjeram. So buaya tak boleh duduk. Terboleh dia. Kan? Dia tak boleh duduk dekat batu. So dia kena duduk dekat air di kuala. So itu beza dia. Selangor dia ada tiga sungai penting. Sungai Langat, Sungai Kelang, Sungai Selangor.
Sungai Gombak.
Daerah asal tiga daerah, enam daerah, Hulu dan Kuala. Hulu Selangor, Kuala Selangor. Hulu Langat, Kuala Langat, Hulu Kelang, Kuala Kelang. So the original six I would say. Right? Then there's an addition of Sepang, Gombak, Petaling lah. And Petaling started from here. So itu tua lain. Saya ada tua lain. Tua Sungai Kelang. So we move forward. That's right. Ni ingat lah, 11 tau.
This is very nice photo. Photo
nak ambil gambar ni. This one tak rare. Pergi Tugu Negara pun lain. Tugu Negara dah dua kali pecah. Sekali pecah, kena boom. 1974, by the communists. So that's why dia punya logo dia lain. Logo dia ada lambang Singapura. It used to have Singapore in the middle. Nanti tengah-tengah tu. Kalau siapa punya sekolah FCK, tahu tak Federated Malay States. The four colours. That four colours MPKK punya lambang dia chill. All the colours of Johor, colours of Negeri Sembilan, Selangor, Perak dan Pahang. And kalau nak lagi nak senang, you tengok JPG punya plate number. A stands for Perak, B stands for Selangor, C stands for Pahang. Unfortunately, Kelantan yang akibat. Sebab Negeri Sembilan dia ada specific N. So nobody is competing against him. So that was the reason lah. So nanti kita lagi satu round lagi boleh lah cerita lain kan. Okay guys.
Ni Melaka ni dulu.
Ya lah.
Kapal apa ni?
Portugis punya. Ni kapal Portugis. Kadang-kadang we miss out benda-benda sini lah. Ya, semua jatah ni semua ada cerita. Kenapa lima keris, kenapa empat kala, kenapa kiri kanan negeri selat. There's always a story about it.
Terima kasih.
Kita akan pergi ke sana. Kita akan pusing one loop sampai ke balik ke sana. Sorry eh. Cuba. Nanti lagi dia nak.
Itu
untuk Commonwealth kan?
Commonwealth.
Main rugby kan? Rugby, yes. Tapi pajar ni memang cantik sebab dia ada sangrai.
Okey je, benar kan?
Malay cakap dia jadi penat. Tak pernah sampai sini.
Masjid itu dia pun
very famous.
From Penang.
Daripada mana? Daripada sini juga
ke? Wow lah. Kalau kita tak kat gambar tak gitu kat mana. Kita cakap dulu.
Every Monday we have a music event.
Up to
disiplin, kesabaran dengan kepanasan itu menjadi sebahagian dari sejarah. Tak ini yang kita perlu.
Tapi being a troubleshooter is also the experience of understanding how the journey to reach towards a perfection, kan? It's always believing the journey is better than receiving towards the receiving end. Sebab kita rasa susah tu, kita boleh appreciate susah tu macam mana. So kadang-kadang bila sebut merdeka, kan, orang sekarang sebut merdeka pergi konsert, pergi merdeka, pergi event apa, pergi, I don't know lah, mengapi kan, that's about it lah. But to be honest, merdeka is more than that. And being an Asian person, eh, kenapa I always mention about Asian? Sebab Asian, dia ada top about values. Kita ada values and virtue, kita ada nilai dan kita ada budi. Dua benda ni sangat penting. Sebab tu dalam tamadun di peringkat dunia, tamadun Cina, tamadun Hindus, tamadun Southeast Asia ni tak ramai orang cakap kita. Tapi we have Borobudur, we have Angkor Wat, we have a lot of things. Tapi bangunan tu tak pernah diceritakan dengan European during that time, because they cannot believe this part of the world can able to do it. Siapa yang ada kesempatan pergi Borobudur, Ayutthaya, eh, pergi ke Angkor Wat, eh, you see how magnificent is the building. It's not because of how majestic is it, but the philosophical part, the filosofah dia. Filosofah dia sebagai satu tamadun itu sangat besar. Saya bagi contoh baru-baru ni, Yogyakarta, kita dah panggil ibu daerah, ibu kebudayaan kepada negara Indonesia. Bandar Yogyakarta mendapat UNESCO World Heritage Site, tapak warisan dunia UNESCO, berdasarkan falsafah bandar dia. Falsafah bandar Yogyakarta ni sangat unik dan dia sebenarnya terpakai kepada keseluruhan bandar-bandar di South Asia. Kenapa? Keraton di tengah adalah bilik raja, istana. Ini berada di lembah. Di kiri dan kanannya adalah para-para agamawan, para-para cendekiawan, membosan, to support the royal to be able to make a decision. Tetapi dia ada falsafah lain, berlatar belakangkan Gunung Meru di belakang, dalam konteks Yogyakarta, Gunung Merapi. Dan di itu bapak dia, ibunya siapa? Samudra Hindi, Laut Hindi, Laut India. Lautan Hindi itu adalah dia punya ibu dia. So di mana sesiapa saja yang marah, kadang-kadang bapak marah, keluar
berapi,
keluar api. Okay. Kadang-kadang ibunya marah, jadi tsunami. Tetapi kami tidak marah sama dia. Kenapa? Dia ialah ibu dan bapakku, memberi aku hidup. Kerana apa? Tanahnya subur, sumber ikannya cukup. Kepada siapa hendak aku berkata buruk tentang mereka? Itu sampah-sampah yang sangat unik. You go to Bali, say, di Malaysia yang paling ketara mana? Sri Menanti. Sri Menanti dikelilingi oleh gunung. Sri Menanti kan? Bukit Putus, Gunung Datuk, Gunung Luang, Gunung Angsi, kan? Sebab ada empat undang. Nak jumpa pertinggian petang besar tu, empat undang tu kena berjalan kaki. Daripada Rembau, daripada Johor, daripada Jelebu, daripada Sungai Ujung. Untuk datang, untuk mengisytiharkan siapa yang akan jadi petang besar. Kerana apa dia berjalan? Sebab tak nak ada indifference. Dia tidak ada, kau Sungai Ujung, kau cakap dengan orang Rembau, kau pilih orang ni, tak ada. So they have to follow a certain route. Certain route tu yang lagi dia susah tu, ada ritual tau, tukar baju. Kat tengah dalam hutan tu, kena tukar baju, kena tukar persalinan untuk membuktikan dia lalu dalam tu. That's how unique and sangat subtle the ritual and also the civilization of us. China, don't mention about it lah. India, don't mention. Our oldest civilization is Indigenous and Euphrates. Kan? Mohenjo-Daro tu semua tu, Harappa tu semua yang paling lama. So kita ni, Persian civilization, we are so well advanced that European cannot cope. That is how kita ni sekarang ni ada adab tata susila ni. Kan, kita dalam ukur lima negara kan, kesopanan dan kesusilaan kan. Kita tak panggil kesopanan je, kita selalu ada datang yin and yang, sopan dan santun, lurus dan ikhlas. Kan, dia mesti berkait satu sama lain because of that. Dan itulah Malaysia as is. Malaysia modern nak bergerak ke depan ni, kita jangan lupa yang di belakang adalah benda yang mengikat kita sebagai satu identiti, sebagai seorang not just a Malaysian tapi seorang Asia. orang yang ada pegangan, ada berfalsafah dalam kehidupan dia. Jadi yang ini memang betul, architecturally is designed by American, naturalized as a British. Stanley Jukes. Stanley Jukes was here as a PWD director. Dia bekerjasama dengan Tukul Rahmat untuk design this, dan dia absorb budaya itu. Dia memahami cara hidup kita. Salah seorang yang popular, yang mungkin ramai orang terlepas pandang, Bobby Shepherd. Bobby Shepherd is the first museum negara punya director, the first arkit negara punya director. She's the key person that see a lot of our traditional building, termasuk Masjid Kampung Laut di Kelantan. He was the person that actually safeguard that masjid. Masjid tu dah runtuh masuk sungai, dia conserve, pindahkan pergi di Lampuri for a certain period of time, until recently it's been moved back to the shore of the Kelantan. That's how, maksudnya orang luar bila dia faham dia philosophical part of being this part of country, they never want to go back. Abu Bakar Shepherd took enough to his word, he embraced Islam and he was he passed away here, and his punya mausoleum is actually in Kubur Jalan Ampang. Kubur Jalan Ampang is a very nice place for you to go to understand. I know some of us might see it as a cemetery, but actually the whole story of modern Melayu is actually in Kubur Jalan Ampang. It's a very very interesting story. Saloma, Piramli, Raja Laut, Raja Bos, you pergi nama Jalan Nakoda Yusof, everybody is buried over there. So there's a lot of story about it. But again, for whatever it is, for today, I thank you again. Terima kasih banyak-banyak sebab meluangkan masa lebih kurang sejam ataupun terlebih sikit. Lebih sikit 6 minit, 5 minit lah, lebih kurang kan. Tapi macam saya cakap tadi dah, kita tak menghadapi kepayahan orang ini. Kita punya kepayahan memberikan masa. So macam saya lah, masa saya pun teka pun dah kering kan. So that is the beauty of all this ni. Saya harap kita dapat sedikit perkongsian tadi, dapat mencetus sedikit of kita punya understanding about Malaysia as a whole, dan harap-harap boleh sampaikan juga pada rakan-rakan yang lain. Kalau nak datang jemput, kalau boleh datang bertua lah. Sebab kalau datang bertua, then you can understand the feeling. Sebab kadang-kadang physical structure ni dia mati kalau tak ada penceritaan. So kita bercerita bukan pasal kita sok bercerita, tapi saya rasa ini tanggungjawab. Tanggungjawab untuk cerita tu ada 11. Itu Melaka lain, Pulau Pinang lain kan. Benda-benda tu kita missing out. So I thank you very much. Anything that you want to ask, please, the floor is yours.